We're recording. Hey, what's up, y'all? It's your girl, Honestly Nay. Here with me, I have Janet. It's our first Zoom interview. Janet, you want to tell the peoples about yourself?
Yeah, so I live in San Antonio, Texas. I provide platonic touch to touch-deficient adults here in San Antonio, which means I do one-on-one sessions where people can come, be who they are, ask for the kind of touch they're looking for, and then we have a conversation around it, if I'm a yes or no to that. And that usually then leads to people feeling really confident in their world, really courageous to ask for touch in their life, and makes the world a better place. And people have, you know,
awesome. Touch. Yeah. How did you get into this touch therapy?
You know, I'm not that person that, you know, I'm not the person that people like, I'm always hugging people, like, nope.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've been working kind of around the field of sexuality, curious about, like, what are the taboos? What are the things that people are really afraid of? And first it was, like, sex, right? Like, ooh, scary. And then when I realized and I went deeper, sex isn't that scary in relationship with platonic touch. Actually, that is harder to access than sex is. So there's a lot of people that can get sex, actually get platonic touch. Like, yes, difficult, especially I would say for our male body people that identify as male, because men are already just assumed that they want sex, that they can't be trusted. We have a lot of feelings around men and touch, and because of, I mean, legit reasons as well, like a lot of people are survivors of men's touch. So like there's a lot of stuff from the peripheral, but there are a lot of men also who can't even access it because of all this stuff. And quite often, I mean, like it starts up in childhood, right, where children can't access. At some age, they lose access to platonic touch, especially young men, young boys. And so then we're creating a culture where there is no touch. And then, of course, then that feels like that acts out in so many terrible ways with abuse, physical, violence, aggression, sexual stuff. Like, it just spills into those areas. And, yeah.
So then, what does platonic touch look like? Because, you know, you hear about touch and you kind of get that image of, like, you know, this touch is going to lead to sex. So what does that kind of session look like with you?
Well, I think the first thing that's important is what's going on in here, like the intention, right? Because you can, like, I can hold your hand and it'd be very sexual, or I can hold your hand and it feels very nurturing. Mm-hmm. And that's just all kind of what's going on in your mind and your heart and in your genitals. Like, there's a need to, like, move the intention somewhere else, right? So, like, what does it look like? It can look like I said, you know, like, holding hands or lying down with someone and just like the only thing that's touching are our arms, because that person may feel really uncomfortable with touch. So I do see people on a regular basis that are touch averse, again, for so many reasons, either not growing up with any touch or they are survivors. And bringing touch back in their life is a very slow process. So it can be like that, with the right force, the intention of it being friendly, nurturing, all the way to what people would call cuddling. Again, cuddling can be nurturing and caring, and it can also be sexual. So it's the intention. What I find that happens is that when people come to me, they ask, you know, like to have an experience of connection, or I'd like to be able to relax. Mm-hmm. And I've been noticing that it kind of correlates a lot with childhood. Mm-hmm. So if someone is in there, can you hold me? Can you just, you know, kind of, I hate to use this word, like pet me, petting, you know, and there's this nurture, it feels very baby, like in their babyhood, baby stage. So that could be really possible. Like, people missed out on that motherly or fatherly or like a parental or somebody, an adult in their life, just holding them. And that's just where they're at. And then as soon as they're able to kind of work through and resolve all that, they can actually have relationships with, like, they're just more complete in their relationships. Because it's really hard to access that kind of touch from a partner. As a woman, if my partner kept asking for, like, babying, at some point I'm like, yo, I just
like I'm done. I can't do it.
Like, I don't want another child. I already have four. You know, like. But quite often, like, that's why having a professional do that work. So, like, if you are a person who has a partner who's always, like, you feel like you have to baby them around touch, don't, you can say, I want to have a sexual relationship with you. Go to a professional to work out those types of things, like the childhood stuff. So that's like baby. And then you have like what I would consider like a toddler, preschool stuff that comes up where it's around identity. And a lot of, some of my clients are like, I don't know who I am. I don't know what I want. I don't know, like, because they weren't able to work out that like toddler yes and no and like their own inner authority. Mm-hmm. And then this is going on. I can continue talking on about like how this then works out. So there are people who are working out these issues. And when it comes from that intention, it feels very platonic to me because I don't know a lot of 8-year-olds that are, I mean, who haven't been sexualized, right? Who are looking for sex. Like, it's really is a, it's very genuine.
Cool. So then what are some of these benefits of the platonic touch?
All right, so if you're looking at it from a biological, you're seeing, okay, right away, like the physical benefits. So this is three major hormones. I tell my clients jokingly that I'm a drug dealer.
Dealing out them hugs, girl.
I know, right? And one of my clients actually thought, he said, I thought I literally had to buy drugs from you. Getting sessions, he's like, I was willing to buy the drugs. That kind of drugs, like that type. So you know, when we look at oxytocin and dopamine and serotonin, like these are truly essential for balancing our mental health and our physical health. You look, these are cancer fighters, right? These are, they lower your blood pressure, they lower inflammation, they lower cortisol, which lowers stress. Like once you start reducing stress in the body, you're fighting all the diseases.
You really are.
I mean, like, I just can't even go, like, a long list to explain that. Mental health. Like, I have one client who is experiencing, like, depression for years. And after a series of sessions, like, he's still taking his meds, which, I mean, I still like to take your meds. your psychiatrist about
right,
that.
Do that. Still do that.
but he's like, but I don't, I mean, even with the meds, he's like, I couldn't overcome the sadness. And now I feel fine. I feel good. Like I'm taking my meds, but I don't have that, still that overwhelming. So you're looking at mental health stuff as well. And whenever you're able to, again, reduce the stress, I mean, just the body just functions a lot better, better breathing, respiratory, of course, like neurological. I mean, your blood is running, but I mean, all of it. And then you're dealing with heart. So most, again, those clients that can move out of their genitals, like what I'm trying to do is decentering genitals, like the center of who you are. So let's move it up into your heart. Let's get into your breath, into your lungs. And I mean, I physically felt clients, they feel like this huge wall, like there's no movement here. And to invite them to go to their hearts is a super difficult thing. And it's not going to happen in therapy. Like talk therapy isn't going to get people to move to this space as easily as if I put my hand there and just move them. Yeah, there's, it's just, yeah, the list is unending of, once you start doing,
all the stuff. Cool. So I hear how you said, you know, you break things down and into kind of those like stages of development, how you're working through like the baby stuff or the toddler stuff or the adolescent stuff. So it sounds like we got to get our kids when they're in these developmental stages. So how do you incorporate this healthy touch and bring this health when you're working with like with your children or if you have other young people in your life, like how can you incorporate these things to make them healthier adults?
So I think we need to recognize that every person on this earth has received unwanted touch and it began in babyhood, right? And when we were little, you know, someone wanted to change your diaper and you didn't want to, and I don't have memory of that, but I'm sure like we would run, right? Because we don't want to like stop playing. So we've had that. And we've all kind of conditioned ourselves to put up with it. And children do the same thing. So finding out like what are you willing to allow and what are you like a hard, like no child, like we have to take it back. You know, if that's like your thing. With my kids, baths were semi-optional. Like I thought, okay, as long as you're not dirty, you're fine, you know? So like figuring out as a parent or as the adult taking care of children, you know, when you go to family's house, a family member's house, and, you know, you typically do, like, you have to hug the family members or kiss on the cheek or whatever, like in my culture, giving the kids the option. It's really hard. Mm-hmm. Because we also want to have our values. Like, our values of our culture is that we do these things that involve touch, and not giving children autonomy around their own bodies.
Mm-hmm.
It's really tricky. So, like, having the hard conversations around, like, these are the times of touch that you can't really, you really can't say no to.
Mm-hmm.
Ouch. It's just really hard, right?
Yeah.
These are the kinds of touch that you have options. So, like, make sure that they actually have parts of their lives where they can have body autonomy. Just really, it's a hard conversation for parents to have. On the other side, like, the other thing that I do is I play a game that I learned, I think, in some workshop. I can't remember who came up with it. It's it may be Betty Martin. Will you, may I?
Mm-hmm.
And I play this, which if you want to get, like, what this actually looks like, so you can go to my YouTube channel and Janet Trevino, and you'll see, like, my kids and I play this game, which is basically, like, I'll demonstrate with you. You know, may I touch your face? And then you would say,
yes, no, yes.
So then I would go and, you know, like, touch my child or touch someone's face. And then that the child would then ask me, like, may I pull your hair? Right. And then I get to decide yes or no. And it, and eventually I'll say, like, something like, may I punch you in the stomach?
Mm.
And, like, my kids immediately are like, no, like, they don't want to be punched in the stomach.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, and then I may say, like, how does it feel to tell me no?
Mm-hmm.
Was that hard? You know, like, was that, and they're like, they go, it wasn't hard because I don't want that. I'm like, great. Mm-hmm. And, like, start feel like allowing them to feel into that no.
Mm-hmm.
And allow them to feel into what's a yes. And then you can talk about, like, did that feel good? Like, and if you could do it again, would you change your mind? Right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, so it's, that's how we learn. We learn through, like, oh, I did that yes thing. And next time I might not be a yes. And that's okay. Mm-hmm. So it's this, like, practicing this game, and we just have fun with it. Like, may I pull your ear, and think of just anything that's even, like, may I pinch you, may I play with your hair. It can be anything sweet, nice, you know, really aggressive, and just allow the child to be in that, in their response with that.
Yeah, I feel like definitely, like, as an educator, when we talk about consent, when we teach consent, we spend so much time teaching people how to say yes, but we never teach them how to say no. And we never teach them how to process their no, or when, how to process when somebody else tells them no. So that sounds like an awesome game. And then especially getting that in that childhood stage, like, because if you can say, no, I don't want you to punch me in the stomach, you can say, no, I don't want you to kiss me, or no, I don't want you to do X, Y, and Z too. So, wow. That's
so really- I'll say I have a 6-year-old. She's my only, my little girl. And she, at home, is really comfortable with people touching her. Like, brothers and whatnot. But at school, we were notified last year that there was a boy who touched her butt.
Mm.
And she was really clearly with a no. Like, and I did not feel good. She told someone. And I was, I mean, it's, of course, that was, like, a terrible experience, I'm sure, for her. But I was really, really happy that she, that I knew, because I didn't know she had a no.
Mm-hmm.
At home, she's very much a yes, like, because she's with family. But I didn't know if someone else did something, if she would feel brave enough to do that. And she did. So, like, it's hard. Yeah, if you're not practicing no at home, like, you know, there's always that question. So it's good to have opportunities where kids, again, have permission to choose for themselves.
Right. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for the work that you do. It's just the first of many conversations. I can't wait to get back into Janet's head and see all the things that are going on. But that's really awesome that you provide the service that people don't think about that they need, because we keep wrapping touch around, like, sex, and we gotta move away from that.
Yeah, so I am creating Touch is Medicine, which the website isn't up yet, but I want to make it accessible to just anybody who's, like, trying to figure out, you know, like, touch is medicine. Like, think about the ways in which we can use touch to provide relief and support, when sometimes allopathic medicine isn't really doing it for us. And then I'm also doing, I have another business. It's called Retouch, so Rehabilitative Touch Therapy, which is for those people who want to begin the process of reintroducing touch into their life, so they could be people that have been outcasts and have had no access to touch, from childhood up to adulthood. For those people who are survivors of physical sexual abuse, and that one's something I'm still learning a lot more. I need to learn a lot about, because that and all of the retouch work actually also is in conjunction with the therapist. With a nice. So I'm not taking on that all on my own. So they get the questions of like why I'm touch adverse from the therapist, and then I address like, let's figure out how and what it looks like to begin that process of reintroducing touch. And then the last group that I'm kind of trying to work, well, this one I'm already working with, are people that are people pleasers who are always taking care of everybody else, mm-hmm. and do not know what they want for themselves and what feels good for themselves. So those populations, and working with therapists and doctors, really hoping to, what is it, to eliminate the gap, that's
knock out that middleman,
right? With
yeah.
access to touch, really, right? It's like, it's not, doesn't have to be sex, because sex is scary.
Mm-hmm.
It requires so much performance, and there's so many expectations and pressure. Like, let's get out of that. Touch doesn't have to be that. Thank you so much for this time.
Yay! Thank you. So I'm gonna have all of your info tag down below. So if y'all want to find Janet, if you need some retouch, if you need some platonic touch in your life, and you're in Austin, in San Antonio. Oh goodness, Texas is ginormous.
Austin, I'll travel anywhere.
Okay. Well, you hear that, y'all? She'll come to you. Okay. So yay! Thank you so much, Janet, for jumping on with me. I can't wait to get a hold of you again, because I love our conversations. We have so much fun together. Okay. Alrighty, y'all. Thank you so much. We'll see you later. And...